Welcome to my channel, Notes Explained, and today I would like to explain the third chapter, Two Stories About Flying, from the book First Flight. So, as I have already explained the first part, now it is time to explain the second part, that is, The Black Aeroplane, written by Frederick Forsyth. The Black Aeroplane. So in this chapter, we are going to learn about a person who was a pilot and he decided to travel all the way from France to England. So let's read the chapter in details. The moon was coming up in the east behind me and stars were shining in the clear sky above me. There wasn't a cloud in the sky. Through the first line, we can get the idea that the person was traveling towards the west direction. Since he said that the moon was coming or rising up in the east and east was behind him. It was a clear sky. How can we get it? Because he said that the stars were shining bright and not even a single cloud was present. I was happy to be alone high up above the sleeping countryside. Why sleeping countryside? It was said so because it was during the night time that he decided to travel or to fly his aeroplane. And at that moment, everyone was sleeping. So that's why it's mentioned that it was sleeping countryside. He was very happy to be above everyone. I was flying my old Dakota aeroplane over France back to England. I was dreaming of my holiday and looking forward to being with my family. So can you see the picture to the right side? Yes, it is a picture of France, and the picture below to the left is England. He took an aeroplane. The name of the aeroplane was Dakota Aeroplane. And he decided that he would not stay anymore in France. He decided that he would go back to England and stay with his family. It is obvious that if we get holidays and we are all alone, we do not want to stay. Because we like spending time or have a good quality time with our family members. So he too decided to go and stay there. I looked at my watch, 1:30 in the morning. So he was that much crazy or that much homesick that he did not see the time. It was night time and it was 1:30 in the morning. It may be dark, but it was the initial part of a new day. It was 1:30 a.m. and he decided that he would go now and would not stay anymore in France. I should call Paris Control soon, I thought. As I looked down past the nose of the aeroplane, I saw the lights of a big city in front of me. So did you see the picture over there? Yes, this is the Dakota aeroplane. So now he decided that since he was above the countryside, he should call the Paris Control Room. Because they would be the one who would show him the direction and guide him to go to England. Now he looked below the aeroplane. He was looking outside to see the view from high above. He was mesmerized to see the beauty because he saw the lights of a big city in front of him. He was really fascinated by the view. Now he switched on the radio and said, Paris Control, Dakota DS-088 here. Can you hear me? I'm on my way to England. Over. So he gave the information to the Paris Control Room about the aeroplane in which he was traveling. It was Dakota DS-088. He was also inquiring whether they were listening to him or not. He also gave the information about the way to which he was flying. The voice from the radio answered me immediately. DS-088, I can hear you. You ought to turn 12 degrees west now. DS-088, over. I checked the map and the compass, switched over to my second and last fuel tank, and turned the Dakota 12 degrees west towards England. So, as he was trying to communicate with the Paris Control, now he got the reply. And they directed him to turn 12 degrees west now. Do you remember last time he was flying towards the west direction? Yes. So now again, he got the direction to turn west once again. And it would be only 12 degrees. So immediately he checked the map and the compass and he turned towards England. He was very much excited, very much delighted to have the English breakfast. Did you see the picture over there? Yes, it was the picture of an English breakfast. He was very much fascinated. He would go and have his breakfast with his family members. So everything was going well. It was an easy flight. But what happened the next time? Paris was about 150 kilometers behind me when I saw the clouds. So, do you remember in the very beginning, he was flying to the west direction? Again, he was directed by the Paris control to turn west once again. So, in this way, he came 150 kilometers ahead. And all of a sudden, outside, he saw storm clouds. They were very huge. They looked like black mountains standing in front of me across the sky. I knew I could not fly up and over them. And I did not have enough fuel to fly around them to the north or south. So they were very huge clouds. They looked like black mountains. Everything was black outside the airplane. He could not fly up or down because he had less fuel. Or he could not fly north or south just because of the fuel that he had. It was too much less. I ought to go back to Paris, I thought. But I wanted to get home. I wanted that breakfast. So for a time he thought that, should I go back to Paris? But he thought that he had less fuel. How could he go back? But again, deep within him, he wanted to go back home and wanted his breakfast with his family members. I'll take the risk, I thought, and flew that old Dakota straight into the storm. So how daring he was that he did not give a second thought. And he decided that he would fly into the storm. By hook or by crook, he would reach England. Inside the clouds, everything was suddenly black. It was impossible to see anything outside the aeroplane. The old aeroplane jumped and twisted in the air. I looked at the compass. I couldn't believe my eyes. The compass was turning round and round and round. It was death. It would not work. The other instruments were suddenly dead too. I tried the radio. So see, the decision that he had taken was a bad one. Because just after proceeding inside the clouds, he could see nothing. Everything was black. The whole aeroplane was covered with a blackish type of mountain like clouds. It was impossible to see anything. The old aeroplane jumped and twisted in the air. The aeroplane did not jump in the real sense, but just imagine the aeroplane was not working properly, so the term was used as jumped. And it twisted in the air. The compass was not working. Instead of showing the 12 degree or 13 degrees, but it was moving round and round. That means it was totally dead. The other instruments as well were dead too. And the next thing that he tried was the radio. Paris control? Paris control, can you hear me? There was no answer. The radio was dead too. I had no radio, no compass, and I could not see where I was. I was lost in the storm. So, again he tried to communicate with the Paris control room, but there was no answer because the radio was dead and the compass was also dead. The decision that he had taken was really a bad one, for which he had to suffer now. But then there was a hope. How? Then in the black clouds, quite near me, I saw another aeroplane. It had no lights on its wings, but I could see it flying next to me through the storm. I could see the pilot's face turned towards me. I was very glad to see another person. He lifted one hand and waved. The pilot was now helpless. The Paris control room was not able to communicate him. All the instruments were not working properly. But he could see another aeroplane moving near his aeroplane. Though it had no lights on its wings, but he could only see the pilot's face that turned towards him, as if trying to communicate through facial expression. I was very glad to see another person. He lifted one hand and waved. So, through the glass, he could only see the person lifting one hand and waving towards him. So, through this way, he felt a bit relaxed. He was not that much tense as before, because he finally knew that he would be safe and would be guided by the second airplane. "Follow me," he was saying. "Follow me." He knows that I was lost, I thought. He's trying to help me. So who was the one telling, "Follow me"? Yes, of course, it was the second airplane. It was trying to help the first airplane because it could understand that it was in danger and it was time to help it out. So the first pilot was feeling gratitude because he was helped by the second pilot. He turned his aeroplane slowly to the north in front of my Dakota so that it would be easier for me to follow him. I was very happy to go behind the strange aeroplane like an obedient child. So what did the strange aeroplane do? It directly came in front of Dakota and it moved towards the north. Remember the direction they were traveling earlier or they were flying earlier? It was first of all west. Again, under the guidance of Paris Control, he was again asked to turn west. Now, the strange aeroplane is helping to turn it towards the north. So remember the direction. Now, he was very happy because he was helped by the strange aeroplane and the first aeroplane was following it like an obedient child. After half an hour, the strange black aeroplane was still there in front of me in the clouds. Now, there was only enough fuel in the old Dakota's old tank to fly for 5 or 10 minutes more. So, the first aeroplane followed the strange aeroplane for almost half an hour. And it was finally out of danger, out of the heavy black clouds. But then, it was again frightened because it had less fuel. He was thinking that how would I follow the strange aeroplane now? Because there was very less fuel. He could not even fly for 5 or 10 minutes more. So that's why he was frightened. But then he started to go down and followed through the storm. That means the strange aeroplane now, it went down. That means it went down the runway. And the first aeroplane, that means the Dakota, also followed and it saw that, oh, I had finally reached a runway. I was safe from the danger that I was undergoing. Suddenly, I came out of the clouds and saw 2 long straight lines of lights in front of me. So he was very much excited when he came down, when he saw that he came out of the clouds, of the dark, huge mountains of black clouds. He was very much happy and excited to see that he was on a runway. He was in an airport finally. But on the other hand, he was also feeling very much gratitude for the other aeroplane who had saved his life. And he began to search for the aeroplane. But he saw that the sky was empty. There was nothing there. The black aeroplane was gone. I could not see it anywhere. So he was a bit sad. He was a bit upset that where was the strange aeroplane? We came together. But where is it? The sky was empty. The airport was also empty. He didn't feel that a sign of another aeroplane being landed. I was landed and was not sorry to walk away from the old Dakota near the control tower. He was finally able to save his life from danger, from the heavy dark clouds. But now he was safe and he was not a bit sorry to walk away from his aeroplane. So why did he say so? He was not sorry to walk away from the old aeroplane. At first, he was very much crazy to go back to England and have his breakfast with his family. He did not see the timing of the day. Though it was night, 1:30 a.m., he set out for going to England. He was very much delighted to have the breakfast. So at present, he thought that his life was much more important than the breakfast that he would have later. That's why he said that he was not even a bit sorry to walk away from the old Dakota airplane. I went and asked a woman in the control center where I was and who the other pilot was. I wanted to say thank you. So, the only query that the person had was that who the pilot was who had finally saved my life. So, he went inside the control room and he asked a woman who was there about the pilot who was there, up there in the storm, to help him out. Because he wanted to say him thank you. He felt gratitude for him. He looked at me very strangely and then laughed. Another airplane? Up there in the storm? No other airplanes were flying tonight. Yours was the only one I could see on the radar. So the woman was trying to clarify herself. She was laughing because it was quite strange to hear. Another airplane? How come in the storm there was no other airplane, sir? There was only your aeroplane that I could see on the radar. So now the first pilot was very much confused because he could not believe his eyes that he saw the strange aeroplane with his own very eyes. And now the lady is telling that there was no other aeroplane. How could it be? So who helped me to arrive there safely without a compass or a radio and without any fuel in my tanks? Who was the pilot on the strange black aeroplane flying in the storm without lights? So yes, as said, the pilot was very much shocked. He could not believe because he saw with his own eyes the strange aeroplane who was showing the direction to him. The first pilot who was without compass, without radio, or very less fuel. He could not have survived if the strange aeroplane would not have guided him. Now, the lady was telling that there was no other aeroplane high in the sky. So it was unbelievable for the first pilot to believe the thing. He was in deep thought who the pilot was flying in the storm, and that also without lights. As I always say, that each and every chapter has a moral lesson. So also, this chapter tells us or teaches us that whenever we have any problem, we should not break down. We should have faith in God and stay strong. We should remain positive and try to find out the solution to it.